16 editions over the last 64 years. 10 different champions, with Spain and Germany leading the way. And countless unforgettable moments. That is the history of the European Championship. Since its inception, every edition of the Euros has delivered legendary matches, thrilling drama, and captured the hearts of football fans around the world. As we delve into the history of the Euros, let's make it a little more interesting by analysing every edition of the tournament since the very first one in 1960. The first tournament hosted by France featured just four teams, including the Soviet Union, Yugoslavia, and Czechoslovakia. Interestingly, the tournament continued in this small four-team format for the first five editions, or until 1980, when the tournament was expanded to eight teams. In 1960, the Soviet Union emerged victorious in a dramatic final at the Parc des Princes in Paris, beating Yugoslavia 2-1. This inaugural competition marked the beginning of what would become one of the world's most prestigious and eagerly awaited football tournaments. And as it was decided from the beginning, the four-year cycle has been followed consistently for every European Championship, with the exception of Euro 2020, which was held in 2021 due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, back to our main topic. The second European Championship was held in Spain in 1964, which had a significant political impact. Yes, it was the first Euro to be won by the host country, something that has only happened twice since. Italy in 1968 and France in 1984, with Spain winning the first of their three titles. However, the road to glory was a controversial one due to their governor and prime minister at the time, Francisco Franco. Spain's journey to victory was marked by both intense matches and political overtones, as General Franco's regime was initially reluctant to face the Soviet Union in the final due to tensions between the two countries. Spain eventually overcame these political hurdles to face the Soviets at the Santiago Bernabéu in Madrid, where they triumphed 2-1 thanks to a dramatic late goal from the legendary Marcelino. Legend has it that Franco had a very competitive nature and wanted to go down in history as the ruler who gave Spain its first great title. That's why the subsequent triumph was greeted with such joy throughout the country, making it a moment of national pride. The 1968 tournament, hosted by Italy, was the third edition of the Euros, with the Soviet Union, England, and Yugoslavia as the other participants. And while the 1964 tournament was remembered for its political controversies, the tournament 4 years later was also highly controversial, but on a purely sporting level. Yes, Euro 68 is the only European tournament to date in which a game was decided by a coin toss. How can matches be decided by luck, you may ask? Well, that's a good question, but one without a reasonable answer. Subscribed. The semi-final against the Soviet Union in Naples ended 0-0 after extra time. There were no penalties, so the result was decided by a coin toss. As luck would have it, Italian captain Giacinto Facchetti tipped the coin correctly, sending Italy into the final. Almost the same thing happened in the final, but this time a far fairer solution was found after the score was level again. Italy and Yugoslavia finished 1-1, and the organisers decided to hold a second leg of the final the following day, which this time ended in a 2-0 victory for the Italians. As for the 1972 European Championship won by West Germany, it seemed to be the first to produce some great legends who are still remembered with nostalgia, including captain Franz Beckenbauer and striker Gerd Müller. The team was coached by another familiar name, Helmut Schön. West Germany's route to the title included a 2-1 semi-final win over hosts Belgium. Then they came up against the Soviet Union in the final at Heysel Stadium in Brussels. West Germany produced a masterful performance to win 3-0, with Müller scoring twice and Herbert Wimmer adding a third. This victory not only marked West Germany's first European championship, but also highlighted their powerful and cohesive team play, which set the standard for future tournaments and cemented their place in football history. Subsequently, Germany went on to win 2 more Euros and 3 World Cups, becoming the world's second best footballing nation after Brazil. Fast forward 4 years, and we come to the creation of arguably the most iconic penalty kick in the world. Yes, the 1976 European Championship saw the birth of the Panenka penalty that we see so often in modern football. The likes of Andrea Pirlo, Karim Benzema, and Zinedine Zidane have scored some of the most beautiful Panenka goals. But they certainly wouldn't have happened if Antonin Panenka hadn't done it in the 1976 tournament in Yugoslavia. The final then pitted Czechoslovakia against West Germany, with the latter having a chance to win back-to-back European trophies. But no, because Panenka was in the right place at the right time. With the two sides locked at 2-2 after extra time, it was up to the penalty shootout to decide the winner, and Antonin Panenka was on hand to take the decisive kick. Instead of opting for a traditional powerful or accurate shot, Panenka boldly chipped the ball gently into the centre of the goal as the German goalkeeper lunged to his left. An iconic execution, which has been replicated thousands of times. Moving on to the 1980 European Championship, we have another historic edition of the tournament. Held in Italy, these Euros marked a significant triumph for West Germany, who became the first team to win the tournament twice. This edition also saw the introduction of a new format, with 8 participating teams divided into 2 groups, with the group winners progressing directly to the final. West Germany, who boasted a team full of talent, including current Bayern Munich boss Karl-Heinz Rummenigge, went through their group undefeated. They were paired against Belgium in the final in Rome. West Germany won 2-1, with striker Horst Rubesch scoring both goals, including a dramatic winner in the 88th minute. The victory highlighted the resilience and tactical prowess of the German team and cemented their status as a continental powerhouse. The tournament was also notable for its format changes and increased competitiveness, setting a new standard for future championships. It's safe to say that from 1980 onwards, the sheer joy and pride of winning the tournament was made all the more special by the increased competition. Now, have you ever heard of the most remarkable and legendary individual performance in the history of the European Championship? Michel Platini in 1984. Period. The Frenchman wasn't just an outstanding player 40 years ago. He was the driving force behind France's first major trophy. Platini was the tournament's top scorer with an astonishing 9 goals in just 5 games, or almost 2 per game, a record that still stands today. His prowess included 2 hat-tricks, one against Belgium and the other against Yugoslavia. The attacking midfielder was a key figure in the knockout stages, scoring the decisive goal in the semi-final against Portugal and opening the scoring in the 2-0 win over Spain in the final at the Parc des Princes. Platini's extraordinary performance was instrumental in Le Blues winning their first international title. And when it comes to the 1988 tournament, let's talk about another phenomenal performance. Marco van Basten's display with the Netherlands in their first year of triumph on the international stage. The Dutch had suffered their fair share of heartbreak, losing 2 World Cup finals in the 1970s. In 1988, however, destiny finally smiled on them as they lifted their first and only major trophy to date. Van Basten was at the heart of that success, scoring crucial goals, including 2 hat-tricks, to lead the team to an iconic final against the Soviet Union at the Olympic Stadium in Munich, Germany. The Netherlands' 2-0 victory was crowned by Van Basten's unforgettable volley from a tight angle, a goal often hailed as the greatest in European Championship history. Next, we come to another remarkable and controversial story from the Euros. At Sweden 1992, Denmark initially didn't qualify for the tournament after being eliminated by Yugoslavia in the qualifying round. However, due to a serious political turmoil and subsequent United Nations sanctions, Yugoslavia, who were ranked first, were banned from taking part. This unexpected turn of events allowed Denmark to step in as a last-minute replacement, and they went on to cause a sensation by winning it all. Denmark's victory culminated in a stunning 2-0 victory over Germany in the final. Yes, no one could have predicted that this hastily assembled team would go on to win the European title, creating one of the most incredible underdog stories in football history and setting the stage for our next legendary moment, Euro 96. For many fans of the game, the 1996 European Championship in England marked the start of a new era of the Euros. The first with 16 teams competing, the first with the final at Wembley. It really was the turning point for a new era and a new feel to the competition. Hopes were certainly high that England would win their first European Championship in 1996, and they did well, but were knocked out in the semi-finals. Led by the respected Terry Venables, England topped their group with a memorable 4-1 win over the Netherlands, followed by a thrilling penalty shootout triumph over Spain in the quarterfinals. However, the semi-final against Germany ended in a 1-1 draw, with Alan Shearer's early goal at Wembley raising the hopes of the home crowd. The atmosphere was similar to the Euro 2020 match against Italy. The whole stadium was behind them. They even had the advantage in the penalty shootout. But once again, the Three Lions came up short as a crucial penalty missed by current manager Gareth Southgate shattered the team's dream. During Euro 2000, fans witnessed something historic. The same nation winning both the World Cup and the European Championship. It happened after France beat Italy 2-1 in the tournament, co-hosted by Belgium and the Netherlands. The French team, who boasted a formidable attacking threat in the form of Zinedine Zidane, Thierry Henry, and David Trezeguet, showed exceptional skill and resilience throughout the tournament. In the end, they came from 1-0 down to beat Italy. However, a late equaliser from Sylvain Wiltord and a golden goal from Trezeguet meant that France were both European and world champions. At the next Euros, however, they were beaten by the sensation of all sensations, Greece. Under Otto Rehagel, the Greeks played a defensive style of football that was dubbed anti-football by their detractors. Well, everyone has their own way of winning, especially Greece, who didn't have the technical ability to play attractive football. After advancing from the group stage, they defeated reigning champions France in the quarters and the Czech Republic in the semis. The final, held in Lisbon, pitted Greece against Portugal. And having beaten them once before in the opening game, Greece proved too much for the hosts, winning 1-0 through a Karastias header. And then, the most outstanding generation of a footballing nation ever, Xavi, Iniesta, Puyol, Ramos, Casillas, Torres, Villa. Spain was packed and won the next two editions of the Euros in 2008 and 2012, becoming the first country to do so. In the span of 4 years, Spain also won the World Cup in 2010, completing an unprecedented hat-trick of trophies. And to add to the drama, the match that is seen as the catalyst for the emergence of this great golden generation was the quarterfinal against Italy in 2008, when Spain won on penalties and then went on to beat Russia and Germany to win their first title since 1964. 4 years later, however, this illustrious cycle was completed with another victory over Italy. This time, far more emphatic. 4-0 in the final of Euro 2012. What an unforgettable and fascinating team that was. And there it was. The long-awaited moment for Ronaldo fans and CR7 himself, finally winning the Euros. The 2016 tournament in France was very memorable and is actually the favourite for the majority of fans for many reasons. The official song, the stadiums, the atmosphere, and of course, the spectacular matches. Portugal struggled in the group stage, but their resilience and defensive play saw them through to the final, where they beat France after Eder's extra time winner. Coming to the last championship, that can be said to have been completed, with Euro 2024 well underway, the 2020 edition will be remembered fondly by many of you, and was unique for many reasons. Firstly, it was the first to be played in not one, not two, but 9 cities across Europe. It also took place a year after it was scheduled due to the pandemic the world was going through. The champions were Italy, who beat England on penalties in the final, only the second time in history that has happened. Normal time ended 1-1 after goals from defenders Luke Shaw and Leonardo Bonucci, but Italy were the better side in the shootout to lift their second European Cup. However, they are yet another team to fail to match Spain's achievement and defend their trophy, having lost 2-0 to Switzerland in the round of 16 at Euro 2024. If you enjoyed today's video of the history of the European Championships, you can give us a like or just check out some of our latest uploads. Also, if you think we missed something of the most memorable moments, you can share your thoughts in the comments section below. Thank you for watching, and catch you in the next one. AGOF. Subscribe.